we've been talking about these axioms of Brahma Within classes. The last time we ended with the splitting axiom, how you can split, curve, and now let us continue with the, I think we have two more axioms. As I said, the splitting axiom is one of the more important ones. So let us do another one, reduction axiom. So we are still discussing axioms of Brahma Within classes. This is the reduction axiom. So what does it say? So gluing together, No, it is being recorded.
Oh,
yes. Gluing together the last two terms, the last two points, gives a loop. So that means that hence the genus, in this case, goes up by one. And so this way, and the number of markers goes down by one. So this way, you get a map, let's call it psi, from compactification of g minus 1, genus g minus 1 curves and n plus 2 points to compactification of g, genus g curves, and well, 2 points of g, and n. Because that becomes actually a node. And so this gives you naturally a map. So if delta A and G A B are as before, so remember that. You could be embedding X inside its product, canonic, you know, and that's the diagonal inside. Call the delta, the diagonal, and this is that inverse of the intersection matrix on X. Then we can make an assessment of what happens if I pull back a, you know, Brahma-Witten class by this map. So what happens, I can look at the primage, and the primage of a stable map from a pointed curve, C1 and D1, to X is the set of isomorphism classes of F, stable maps, F, C, P1, to Pn plus 2 to X of genus G minus 1 such that push forward the class of curve is equal to beta, and f of pi's are going to be lying inside these cycle zi's, where the zi's are the dual of the cohomology classes, we call them alpha I, so far I from 1 to n, and f of pn plus 1 going to be equal to f of pn plus 2, you know, because we are gluing the points together, which is equivalent to saying that, which is same as saying this tuple, tuple f pn 1 and n plus 1 and f of pn plus 2 lies in diagonal of x times x. That's why this diagonal comes in, and the class of the diagonal comes in. Okay? Which has class. This diagonal, remember that this diagonal has class summing over all I and J, G I J, T I, S and T J, and these are some basis of cohomology theory. We discussed it last time. Again, like the splitting principle, whenever you identify the points with each other, you see the appearance of these cohomology classes. Here also the same way, you're identifying two points of the same curve. Before we were identifying a point of one curve and the other, here we are identifying two points of the same curve. Okay. So what does that give us? Is the following. So psi star of Sarastra star of I G and beta alpha 1 to alpha n is going to be summing over I n j g I j I g minus 1 n plus 2 beta of alpha 1 to alpha n t I and t j, both of them on the same class. Before, it was a tensor product of two Brahma-Witten classes, because there you're identifying two curves with each other. So that was some Brahma-Witten class of alpha p1 to pn minus 1 at a ti tensor with something else with a tj in the first order. But here now you're identifying them both. So both of the classes would be one Brahma-Witten class. Okay, so this is the reduction axiom. Now remark, as I said, splitting axiom and reduction axioms are important. So splitting and reduction axioms are most important ones, which imply, later we will see, associativity of the quantum cohomology. Okay. All right, so this is the reduction. There is also another axiom, and you know, today we will be doing a calculation. Hopefully, I'm not sure if we do genus zero Brahma-Witten invariant calculation for. I'm sure we can do it for projective plane. We have enough time to do it for projective plane. I'm not sure if we can do it for Clavier threefold. That maybe we can do it on ourselves. I really prefer that starting from next week to go to quantum cohomology. But you do one example of genus zero Brahma-Witten invariance, and you will see how useful these axioms are. You will use them directly to compute the Brahma-Witten invariance. Okay. What else can I say? There is this deformation axiom. Which states the following. Let f from x tilde to t be a smooth proper map with connected base T. Okay, suppose we have that, and let X of T denote F inverse of T for T and T this is somewhat discussing the invariance, the deformation invariance of these things. You have a family of these varieties. Thus, for each t in t and beta t in second integral cohomology of x of t, like that, we obtain a map. We obtain a map, which we called it I, G, and beta, except here we are looking at family, so I call it I, G, and beta t of x t, if you like, which takes us from rational cohomology, n-fold rational cohomology of x of t to rational cohomology of modified space m bar gn. Right? So this is the grammar within the class. This is the definition of it. And then if beta t is a locally constant section of H2XT Q, then the statement is that, okay, so maybe I also mentioned something about these cohomology classes. Alphas also satisfy that problem. So, and alpha 1 to alpha n are locally constant, okay, sections of homology theory of XT. Then I x t g n beta t of alpha 1 to alpha n is constant. That's the statement. So, intuition behind this, and this is really a mouthful if I actually want to prove it, we need to go back to the definition of virtual cycles and things like that. It's actually related, whenever done. Basically, the intuition is that the Gramov-Witten classes are also deformation invariant, deformations of the complex structure. However, remember that when I said virtual cycles, of course, you can define the Gramov-Witten classes whenever it makes sense. You can define them by a Gramov-Witten invariance, or the other way around. So it's a priori non-trivial to say that Gramov-Witten classes are deformation invariants. Right? These are just push forward of some pullback of classes. So that's it. Gramov-Witten invariants, on the other hand, yes, they are defined via integrations against the virtual cycle, and it is embedded in that construction that it's intrinsic in that construction that they are invariant, their definition. When the two definitions kind of are related to each other, invariants versus classes, then yes, you can see trivially. However, a priori, that's not the case. These are just cohomologies of the modular system, M bar GN, basically. But that's the intuition. That is the last axiom. Okay, so let us do today some examples of computations. After all, in the syllabus, it says we do some computations. So let us see how these axioms help. This is going to be computing Gramov Witten invariants in some examples. Computations. So before working on a concrete example, let us just study these tree-level classes. I'm going to discuss tree-level classes. This is what they're called. So when genus is equal to zero, I, zero, and beta, and betas are tree-level classes, and that because of Gramov-Witten classes, this is due to the fact that for these guys, stable maps are chains of are trees of P1, stable maps of genus 0 are given by trees of P1s. That is why we call them tree level classes. The genus 0. Of course, this is one of the most interesting objects for physicists because these are also, even pictorially, these are related to tree-like Feynman diagrams. In quantum field theory. Now since for I, G, and beta, we require n plus 2g to be bigger than or equal to 3. Remember that for Gramov-Witten invariants we didn't require that. The tree-level classes are defined for n with genus 0 and bigger than or equal to 3. By the way, in the syllabus, I think there has been a typo. It's called three-level classes. They're not three-level, it's the tree-level classes. But these are, you know, the at least one of them is three-level class. So that's the tree-level class. Now, recall that, because these are classes in cohomology of M bar Gn, and here the genus is zero, the moduli space, M bar zero, n is an orbifold. Our orbifold of dimension n minus 3. So yes, when n is equal to 3, we have that before it becomes a point. When n is equal to 4, it was a P1, remember, we did the study that. It was a P1 minus the 3 points on which you are identifying these divisors. And that was something that was important for us because the rest of M bar Gns, via some sort of splitting the curve, you can always fiber it over this 4 points. So if you have N bar points, you can forget N minus 4 of them and you get mapped to the moduli space of M04. And on N04, you have these divisors, the three divisors, which are linearly equivalent. So those imply that M on them, M for 0 n, you have also divisors. Remember that
difference between this border space and the Hilbert scheme of Poisson.
What's the difference? Well, the difference is that the Hilbert scheme points on the curve. Well, if you have a fixed curve, this modulus does see the deformation of the curve. The stabilities are different, for instance. You know, the Hilbert scheme points on the curve, for instance, is an Artin step. Because if you have a curve, if you have ideal sheets of points on the curve, that's a stable object. That is a stabilizer to see stuff. So naturally, the Hilbert scheme is an Artin step. Naturally, this one is not. It has finite high-level stabilizers. But the level of coarse moduli spaces
I thought the Hilbert scheme curve was a smooth scheme. Why is an Artin step?
Hilbert scheme of the curve.
Yeah, points on the curve. It's a smooth step.
Is it? It is.
Maybe, yes, maybe it's true. Let me just see.
I'm not saying it's not a smooth. You're saying it's a smooth.
Yeah, it's the same thing with M0.
It could be, yes, it could be. Let me just see.
The underlying force modulus scheme is smooth, I think, that I created. You see, I'm just talking about the functorial construction of the Hilbert scheme.
Yeah, I think the Hilbert scheme is. Oh, yeah, on P1, it's probably just.
Yes, on P1, it's just
PM. Yeah, over C1.
It's just P of N. Yeah.
Another difference is that M0 is a positive
order. Yes, whereas. And also, this is the order. That's right.
So then even after you quotient up by the.
Here, if you have 4 points now, the moduli space is still.
It's going to collapse
something. Yes, I think it is correct. The scheme is smooth on the curve. That's right. That's right. Even on the surface, it's smooth. If the surface is smooth. That's right. However, the dimensions don't match. Yes, that is right. You have the statement. Okay, so this is an orbital of dimension n minus 3, the theorem, which is called the reconstruction theorem. Reconstruction theorem due to Kantsevich and Manin. Let X be a smooth projective variety such that cohomology of X is generated by H2. assume I0 3 beta, invariant I0 3 beta of alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 is known for some beta and H2 of X. The Z coefficients, okay, satisfying some beta satisfying minus degree of omega against beta is less than dimension of X plus 1. Beta satisfies this condition, and degree of alpha 3 is equal to 2, then we can determine all three-level Gramma-Witten classes, are going to be I, 0, and beta, all of them, alpha 1 to alpha n, for any curve class, for any such curve class in H2, by this invariant. So in some sense, basically, this is really remarkable. It says that if you know this particular three-level invariant for such cohomology class beta which satisfies this condition, then you know all Gramma-Witten classes. So this saying how to recover Gramma-Witten classes from Gramma-Witten. This is called reconstruction theorem. Okay. So it has several steps. So first of all, it has the step where somehow you would like to prove that Gramma-Witten classes somehow can be recovered from Gramma-Witten invariants. And then it has the step, some sort of inductive step, saying that the higher degree Gramma-Witten invariants, if you like, can be determined by the Gramma-Witten invariant of three modules. Your question, you can also see a significant difference of the Hilbert scheme picture versus the moduli space of genus G, M or Gn. Just look at the stability. That was my point. Just look at the stability of these things, for instance. For genus zero curve, reducible, for instance. Just look at the stability, what it does, it implies. We had those rules, how many markings and so on you can have on the components. But the Hilbert scheme doesn't see that, I don't think. Much, much different. Hilbert scheme of points on the curve doesn't see any of that. Okay, so this is the reconstruction theorem. Proof of this. So step one of the proof is that show that I, zero, and beta Brahma within class can be determined by Brahma within invariant. Step two is to show that use induction on N and assume N is bigger than 3 since M bar 0, 3 is a point. Those are identified naturally on a P1. The three natural points on a P1, it's just one configuration, so it's a point. Now consider, so these are the first two steps. Consider the map we got from the splitting axiom. So consider a map phi from M bar G1 and 1 plus 1 times M bar G2 and 2 plus 1 to M bar G of N, where G is equal to G1 plus G2 and is equal to M1 plus M2 as in a splitting axiom. And you will see that the image, the phi of some stable map F1 from C1 to P1 to Pn, 1 plus 1, 2x, and F2 from C2, Q1 to Q, and 2 plus 1 to x, for G1 equal to G2 equal to 0 is a divisor in M bar 0 n. Right? This is exactly where we use that idea. So we know that this guy's fibered over M bar 0 4 with the divisors, right? So we know that whenever you fix the configuration of points on two curves like that, you fix the partition of points on the partition of points on the two curves, which are basically elements in here. If I ask G1 and G2 be equal to 0, you will get divisors inside this. So the image of these kind of the stable maps, where G is equal to 0, is a divisor in. And those divisors, remember also we had this result that those divisors generate the cohomology theory of M1, 0, n. This was a result of Q. So this had to do with looking at, recall this was the side discussion where you would fix and one many points in here by given a partition and two many points in here we call it A and D. These induced divisors on that module. Okay, so moreover, permuting the points we get other divisors number 0 n and Q. To the Q, actually, we know that cohomology theory of M bar 0 n is generated visor glasses. Why such? Determined by its intersections with these dividers. Those are the generators of homology. Okay. Now you can consider I zero and beta alpha one. In here, okay, and if it is of top degree, if this class is of top degree, two things can happen. So if it is of top degree, then easily see that whenever it is of top degree, then it is related to the Gromov-Witten invariant. So I0 and beta of alpha 1 to alpha n is equal to the Gromov-Witten invariant. Because if it's top degree, then it's the class of a point that has the highest codimension. And if it's not, it is determined by intersection with divisor classes. Let's call them something DAB, and these are classes of divisors in the modular space which parameterize pictures like genus zero pairs with a partition of A points in here and a partition of B points in here. So I call them DAB.
Is there any like a fundamental difference between this proof and the ultimate ponder upon these notes when they prove what they say at recursion by the
No, no. Yes.
Just that proof.
Yes, yes.
What about going from Gromov-Witten invariants to tree like invariants? Is that part of your very first step?
From Gromov-Witten invariant to the tree level class.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yes, for there I don't think you can. What do you want to do?
I don't know how to do it.
No, it's you cannot much do from Gromov-Witten to tree level. The reason that we can do it this way is because the Gromov-Witten class, you can go from Gromov-Witten class to Gromov-Witten invariant because you can intersect the classes with each other. Each time you're intersecting the class, class is some sort of pullback of the class and integrating. So the coefficients are determined by the Gromov-Witten invariants. So that's why going from class to Gromov-Witten invariant is, at least I can see it, but from Gromov-Witten
invariant. So sorry, I'm forgetting the definition. The Gromov-Witten invariant class is the difference between the two.
The Gromov-Witten class is the cohomology class in the M bar G. You have n classes on X.
Oh, okay.
You pull them and pull them back
okay.
to the stable map moduli space and then push it forward, forget the map. You get an unstable curve with several unstable components. Contract those things so
right,
you
okay,
land
so
on M bar GN.
And then the other one is you just integrate straight.
Yes, right. The
and
other one is you just integrate straight on upstairs on the moduli space of the stable mass.
And then how do you get the.
Now, if the Gromov-Witten class is of top degree, degree, then the Gromov-Witten invariant is equal to Gromov-Witten class is equal to Gromov-Witten invariant times the top degree class, which is the class of a point. Do you see what I mean? So Gromov-Witten invariant is the integral of the pullback of Gromov-Witten class to the moduli space of the stable mass. That's it.
Yeah.
So if this pullback has the expected dimension, that integral is non-vanishing, and that's the Gromov-Witten invariant. Otherwise, it doesn't exist.
Yeah, yeah. And then you're saying that you get the class.
Yes. Yes, yes. For instance, in this case, if the Gromov-Witten class is of top degree in here,
yeah.
it is the class of the whole space, right?
Yeah.
So how is it related to the Gromov-Witten invariant? It is the Gromov-Witten invariant times the point class. As a class, it is this class. It comes from integral. No, you should compute Gromov-Witten invariant separately, but then you know it is of top degree. You use that property to say it's times the class of a point. The class of a point is the highest top code dimension.
I have a feeling
that's
fine.
Gromov-Witten invariants, whenever they make sense, whenever the relation to Gromov-Witten invariant classes makes sense, are basically the coefficients that recover how the class is expanded. Generators of the cohomology. So if you have some Gromov-Witten class which is not of top degree, then how do you understand it in the cohomology ring, right? You should look at the generators of the cohomology and see how is that class written with respect to the generators. Of course, you have coefficients. The coefficients are intersections, and that's where you integrate these classes.
Oh,
and
you say
we
pull that off the
yeah.
splits.
Exactly. That's right. Exactly. But if it is of top degree, then there's nothing, you know, there's just the point class, we know what it is. So if the pullback has the top degree of the cohomology, then it's just one number times a point class. Okay. So if it is not of top degree, yeah, so it is determined by intersection with these divisor classes, so we know that I0 and beta. Alpha 1 to alpha n intersected with a class of such divisors. And what does this mean now, intersecting with the class of such divisors? Remember that we had this map (1+1). Where G was this and N was this, and here G is equal to 0. So intersection with the divisor class in here means intersection with the image of psi. So these are inside image of left side. So that means that this is equal to, or phi, I call it phi. Yeah. So this is equal to pull back of this class. Okay. Okay. And so we are pulling back now by splitting axiom. This is nice because now we are pulling back, and this is precisely the statement of the splitting axiom. What happens if I have Gramov Witten class in here? I pull it back. What happens now by a splitting axiom? This produces this procedure, produces somewhat Gramov-Witten classes of a smaller genus. And a smaller number. This is that reductive part of the construction. So you use induction on n, determine that for some of these n's, the Gramov-Witten number and the Gramov-Witten classes are determined from that. And then to go lower and lower in the number of Markov points, in the genus at least, you can actually.
What does genus matter?
No, Markov points. Smaller degree Gramov. Smaller. Okay. Now you can also note that you get these divisors by fixing partitions, but you can permute the points. Right? So for that you need to use equivariance. So furthermore, the equivariance with respect to action of Sn shows that this is the same as other divisors. The result is the same. This result is the same for other divisors. Which we obtain by permutations. Points and so therefore this implies that I zero and beta alpha 1 to alpha n determined by Gramov-Witten invariance and the other. Yes, because this procedure depends on fixing the particular partition The argument is that if you do the permutation, a covariance axiom tells you that the Gromov-Witten numbers are the same onto a sign. So for all such generators of the cohomology of MRGN, you can do this construction inductively. So that you can reconstruct your Gromov-Witten classes from. So there's been three level. You can reduce the number of Markov ones each time. Okay, so so this is the part that says Gromov-Witten numbers and the Gromov-Witten invariants. Gromov-Witten classes can be determined by Gromov-Witten. Variants, and so there's also reduction. So step three, we need to study the invariant I zero and beta. There are certain linear relations. I'm just writing this sloppily because I don't want to go through the detailed proof of conservation money. There are certain sort of linear relations between these divisors. Divisor DABs, which induce quadratic relations, certain quadratic relations among the invariants. And if alpha I's are homogeneous classes, then I zero and beta, alpha one, alpha two, alpha three is equal to zero unless these conditions are satisfied. So the sum of the degree of alpha I's is equal to two times dimension of the virtual the degree of the virtual class. The degree of the virtual class should be equal to two times omega x beta. On the other hand, we know that sum of the degrees of alpha i's, we know that is less than two times the dimension of x plus two. So by combining these two, we get the inequality for the class beta, combining these two. These two gives us the inequality for class beta. Wanted this inequality. So this is that's just completely completes the book. Covers the book. Okay. So this is the discussion about these. So now let me do one example of computation of these Gram-Witten invariants, the three-level invariants, so that we can see. So then we have the reconstruction theorem. I'm going to compute some of these invariants for you, exactly the same construction as before. So we are using these intersection of Gram-Witten classes with divisor classes of MRGN. So that you can see how much of the axioms we use. We already used them here, so splitting axioms. This is now going to be a more concrete example. So concrete example, let us calculate, let us fix the x via projective plane. Let the line denote line in P2, the line. This is my line in the P2. Let us fix some degree bigger than or equal to 0. And we would like to calculate this number. We want to know what these things are. Genus 0, Gram-Witten invariance of projective plane. You want to calculate that. Okay, so we have done some of these examples. So for instance, we can ask, what is this thing? Three mark points, and, well, by the way, notation. This is a notation, and we have used it before. We can use this notation, degree d maps, because this is d times class of line. So this is degree d maps. So we can use, we can compute this invariant. Okay. So what is this? This is basically the Gram-Witten invariant associated to moduli space of a stable mass. So here we are looking at set of isomorphism classes of a stable mass with set P1 and 3 points on it. P1, P2, P3 to a line in P2, degree 1. The line in P2. Such that each one of these points lie there, are prescribed by points in P2. Okay, so basically, here f of P1. F of P2, F of P3 are prescribed. Points. Yes. No, this is obvious, I mean. By the way, what is this number? You fix 3 points in P2. You're sending a P1 to P2 such that it passes through the Facebook. There's a unique map to it. That's it. So this is obvious. It's just one. Now, to make it more exciting, I can change one of these classes, for instance.
Oh, wait. Mm-hmm. 3 points, this should be 0.
What?
If you pick 3 points, it's not like.
that
the answer here is
the
like if you pick point, point, and like
oh, yes, yes. If you pick point, point, and a line, yes. Wait a minute. Is the it is zero not because we cannot fix a point, it is zero because of degree, the degree formation. That's what you're saying. Yes, yes. Yes, you're right, actually. If I fix this to be class of aligned instances. So I want two of the points in P2 fixed, and I fix a line in P2, and I ask the third point to simplify. I fix two points in P1, P2. I want f of P1 goes to this and f of P2 goes to this. Then I fix a line in P2 and I want my f of P3, for instance, lie on that line. Say these are prescribed points and f of p3 lies in the line. But these are in general. There's no group. Yeah, that's right. Okay. So this is, I think, yeah, this is the first non-trivial. First non-trivial example. So here, since d is equal to 1, the image of f is determined by the line passing through. Fixed points and hence f of p3 is determined by basically the image of the whole p1. And we get a unique genus zero stable map. So we get a unique genus zero stable map this way. And we can show that this is the only one, basically. So I031 of point class of a line must just be 1. That's the first example. Okay. Now, let us do another example now for I0 and D of 1 to n by point mapping axiom. We can assume D is bigger than equal to 1. These are going to be. And so we can assume also that each wait a second. It's not like, it has to do also with the degree of these alpha i's. So if t is equal to zero, you're looking at maps to point, and it depends on some of the degree of these cohomology classes. If the degree is top degree of the x, then it will be just top product of all of the alpha i's over x, which is, you know how to do. Otherwise, it is zero. That's why we could come in. It's trivially understood, so we can assume that d is bigger than or equal to 1.
Yeah.
So, so each alpha I is P2 or class of a line or a point. Also, my degree axiom we know that sum of I to n of degree of alpha i's is going to be 2 times 1 minus g, dimension of x minus 2 degree of the canonical plus 2 times 3g minus 3. So if we do this in this calculation in here, we can see that the genus in here is 0, so this is 2. Dimension of x is 2, so that's 4, minus canonical of p2 is p2 minus 3, so this would be, and this is the class of a line, so this is just degree d, so this is some d times class of a line. So this is minus 3d plus 6d plus minus 6. Plus 2n. This is 60 minus 2 plus 2n. So when d is bigger than or equal to 1, the degree axiom tells me that the degrees of these alpha i's needs to satisfy this relation. And now this actually puts some restrictions on these alpha i's. So for instance, for n equal to 0 and 1, this equation does not have a solution. And for n equal to 2 and 3, one checks that basically on I0, 2, 1 of point is equal to I031 point class of a line, which is going to be equal to 1. So this is somehow very similar to the reconstruction theorem. You can see now you're trying to calculate these Gromov-Witten invariants. So we are using axioms. So first, point mapping axiom is putting restrictions on D. So D should be bigger than or equal to 1. Otherwise, we know what the Gromov-Witten invariant is. And then there is degree axiom, which restricts some of the degree of alpha i's to be this number. Doesn't have a solution for n equal to 0 and 1. What happens for 2 and 3? Well, it has a solution. But for 2 and 3, we have this identity. So can you tell me where is this identity coming from? Excellent. That's the divisor axiom, because the line of the divisor, then basically we remember that you could relate the Gramma-Witten number, and for the last class you would see how many choices you have. You integrate that divisor class against the curve. So you would get this invariant. Yes. So maybe write it down. So we call divisor axiom, which was saying that the invariant of IG and beta alpha 1, 2, alpha n minus 1, alpha n, is you take the last class, calculates a degree, and then times IG n minus 1 beta of alpha 1 to alpha n minus 1. This is what the divisor class axiom implies. So this number is going to be 1. And then this number, so we are basically looking at that. So then this number, we know already what that is. This is basically what we just calculated. It's just unique and stable number. So this is this guy. Okay, so this is for n equal to 2 and 3. And then, if n is bigger than 4, what happens? If n is bigger than or equal to 4, then I0 and d of alpha 1 alpha n will be equal to 0 if sum alpha I is equal to plus of p2. This is the by the fundamental axiom, or by the fundamental class axiom. Class of the ambient space. Similarly, if n is bigger than equal to 4, and alpha n, for instance, equal to class of a line, then again you will be using this divisor axiom computation. And then say by divisor axiom, you can say that I zero and d alpha one alpha n minus one class of the line is equal to d times I zero. N minus 1 d alpha 1 alpha n minus 1. This is the intersection of the line with the d times the line. This d, this vector d. And then can proceed inductively. So here we can continue inductively, and we will get the formula and it remains to compute basically I0 and d, where all of them are point classes, degree of a point is going to be equal to 4. Complex codimension 2. Then from here we can see that n is going to be 3d minus 1. You have this degree axiom on the cohomology classes, so that forces n to be 3d minus 1. And so we need to calculate this number. So we end up studying, let's call it n of d, which is the I 0 3d minus 1 in d of that many point classes. For d bigger than 1, and how many point classes in here? There are, of course, 3d minus 1 many point classes. Okay, so when the class is the fundamental class, when one of them is fundamental class, we get vanishings. When we have divisor classes, we use the divisor axiom, we inductively can proceed. The only case that we need to now compute is I0 and D for point classes. Okay. This is the Gramov-Witten invariant of rational points in P, rational curves in P2 of degree d, passing through 3d minus 1 points. It actually appears to be also this degree of the Severi variety of degree d rational curves, which is cool because you can see that somehow you're using a stable mass to compute those. But there's a difference kind of between the point of view of stable mass rather than counting curves inside, just counting curves. You can use a stable mass to compute numbers for counting curves on a variety. This, and now there is this formula I would like to remark on. So the final formula for this computation of this, these and these final formula would be something like this. Will be the following formula, which you might have actually seen in the notes of Henri Pandey and Fulton of Henri Pandey or many other notes. So I 0, 3d minus 1, d. Point classes. It's going to be summing over d1 plus d2s, d1 bigger than d2. N of d1, N of d2, d1 squared, d2 squared, 3d minus 4 choose 3d minus 2, minus d1 cubed d2, 3d minus 4, 3d minus 1. So this is this recursive computation of Gramov-Witten invariants, as you can see, it is recursive with respect to the degree. Obviously, you can see the connection between this and reconstruction. One of the the coolest formulae in the Gram-Witten theory. So for instance, using this identity, if N1 is going to be by definition, it is I0 to 1 2-point classes, this is equal to 1, we just calculated it by the divisor axiom. And from here you can see that N2 becomes N3 becomes 12, and from here you can see N4 becomes 620, N5 becomes 8, 7, 3, 4, and so on and so forth. So now let me just say a little bit about proving this recursive formula. Proof of recursive formula. Let us think about a class. Call this class psi of C, I0 3D, not 3D minus 1, but 3D. This many point classes. Class of a line. Come on, the theory of M0 3D Q. 3D minus 2-point classes, and then 2 class of a line. We use this class to compute. The goal is to compute this invariant. This invariant, but use this class to compute that invariant. Okay? So just consider this class. Let us play with it. So by degree axiom, this is the class of degree 2 times dimension. So we can just sum up degree of these guys, 2 times dimension of M0 d, and whenever I say degree, I'm looking at real dimension, so minus 2, 2 times dimension of M0 d minus 2, so it is intersection, it has this codimension 1 class. This is the real codimension, so complex codimension 1. So its intersection with the divisor is well defined. So its intersection with the divisor class is well defined. Okay. Now let us pick some divisor. So we need some divisor in M0 3D. gives a partition again. Gives a partition of indexed 3D points unstable. M bar 03D, and for that we use the set. So by the set, let the set be I going from 1, 2, 3, -4, and then PQRS. Okay. So this means that this class C or C will have the property that alpha 1 is equal to alpha 3D minus 4 equal to alpha P equal to alpha Q equal to a point classes, and alpha R is going to be the same as alpha S is going to be a line class of line. So we are partitioning certain stable mass in here. So we pick some index set. We are looking at 3D points, 3D minus 4 of which are point classes, two of them are line classes. And then we give a partition where 3D minus 2 of these things are point classes, and then only two of them are line classes. And then we distribute them on the curves. Still genus theory. What happens now? Partition I. Now we can partition I, the set I, into disjoint sets. Let's call them A and B. Is the same as in splitting principle or splitting axiom. And this gives a natural map. Again, the map that appeared in the splitting axiom, which induces a map. We call this C of A, B, going from M bar 0, A plus 1 times M bar 0 B plus 1 goes to M bar 0 3. Okay. And then we can just look at the image of this map. So the image of AB is a divisor in there, is a divisor in M bar 03D. And we have this linear equivalence of divisors in here that we understand, we have discussed many times. So in particular, we can look at the image of let's say AB, and we have those point classes and the line classes. Now we are breaking our curves, and we have some of the classes in here, some of them there. So we can have R and S to be in A, and sum over partitions where P and Q are in B, which is going to be linearly equivalent to summing over P and R in A and Q and S. So if someone says, what is this divisor? The fiber of this basically what you will get as the fiber of the image of phi inside here over, so you know that you can forget, by forgetting the 3D minus 4 points, you can land on m bar 0, 4. And inside here, you have those divisors as given by the three unique points of P1. Here you have 4 points really, you have each kind of things. And so, for instance, this guy is the fiber of image of this in here over a point in here over the stable map where R and S are in here and P and Q are in here. And the other one is where R and P are in here and Q and S are in here. We have these two dividers. And now we know. Oh, okay, so. Yeah, so the linear equivalence of these divisors that we obtain in here again is because of the linear equivalence of the divisors of m bar 0, 4, the unique points of P1. So you get the linearity here. That's the image of. Now, let us call D one of these divisors. So let D and B, let's call them D A B, yeah? Be this one. R, S, and B, P and Q and A, and Q and B, image of C, A, B. Then, we have this psi class, which was complex codimension 1, right? And to determine it, we know that we can intersect it with divisors, that's codimension 1. And this is an honest divisor, so then we can ask, what does it mean, intersecting this thing with the divisor DAD? But again, like before, we have the divisor in here. We have a class in here, and we would like to understand intersection. But because that divisor is image of phi, that is the same as pulling back that class over there. And then we can use the splitting principle to do computations. Again, same game. So this is given by, which is equal to pull back of this class psi, which we calculate by a splitting principle, or by a splitting axiom. Okay. So let us spend the last 5 or so minutes. So remember that. So basically, this gives us the following. So we know that the upper star I, G, and beta and summing over beta 1, beta 2 tensor with I G 2 and 2 plus 1 into 2 Tj alpha. Which is for a particular partition, but we have the equivariance by permuting the classes, so we can apply. So, however, we can apply. So, just to summarize, we are calculating Gramov-Witten numbers of genus 0, degree D maps into the P2. We did this one by one. Simplest possible example is that you have D equal to 1, a line in P2, and you have three classes, two of which, first simplest example is that all of your classes, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, n should be bigger than 3. Of course, 3, bigger than or equal to 3. So alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, all of them are point classes. That's just 0. Next is two point classes and a line class. That means that in the P2, you have a curve with three mark points. You want to send the mark points to two fixed points on P2, such that there is a line passing through them. And then you need a third point. So where is that third point? That's basically naturally given by looking at image of P1 inside P2, wherever it intersects that line. So that we calculate. Then we, for general n, when n is bigger than 3, we did this computation one case by case. So first we argued on the cohomology classes alpha i's. We looked at situations where alpha i's, at least one of them is a, the whole class of P2. It could be. If it is, then we know how to do that calculation. That's the fundamental. If D, then we argued about D, here beta for us is going to be D times class of 1. If D is equal to 0, that means you're using point mapping axiom. Again, you know what the calculation is. Either you get 0 or the integral of the cup product of all of the cohomology classes. Then we said, okay, let's say D is bigger than 1. If D is bigger than 1, what situations we can have? We can have, well, fundamental class axiom gives a zero invariant, that we know, so none of them can have class of P2, but they could have class of a line. Then we realize that whenever we put a class of a line, because it's a divisor, the divisor axiom reduces the computation force. So we eventually boil down to the situation where all of the alpha i's are point classes. Then we use the degree axiom to get a restriction for what this degree should be. We have the degree axiom, which precisely tells us what's the sum of the degree of cohomology classes going to be. And because the point classes are degree 4, they're co-dimension 4, co-real dimension 4. In P2, they're co-dimension 2. So co-dimension 4, we add them up and realize that n should be 3 times d minus 1. Then we calculate this, we want to, our goal is to calculate this invariant, D, like that, where we have all the point classes in here, 3D minus one of them. And then now we are playing a game. We are saying, let's just look at the Gramov-Witten class, which has 3D points on it. D minus two of them are point classes, two of them are line classes. And somehow using the divisor axiom like in here, we are recovering this particular invariant from this particular Gramov-Witten class. That's the game. It's a trick. And that's what went into the proof of this recursive formula. Okay, so this is what I just wanted to say. summarize what we are doing. So we are doing one of those situations in here by looking at grammar within classes of 0-3D. Okay, so we have that. Now, we want to calculate this formula. How do we do it? Let us actually do this for P2. Remember that these are the basis of cohomology theory of P2. And so let's just write down the diagonal class. So the class of diagonal inside P2 times P2 is written as is the following. You know, so I mean this has a very easy cohomology theory, point class, line class, all of P2, right? So this class of delta is written as point times P2 and then plus lines times line plus P2 times point. As easy as it is. So all I need to do, I need to distribute these classes. This is going to be Ti and Tj for me always. And I'm going to distribute these in here. So I'm going to. So we'll get the following pullback for a particular partition of this class psi, and once again I03D. I don't want to make mistakes. This is this class. So pullback of this thing is given by the following identity, which is equal to summing over all d's, d1 equal to d2 of I0, we have fixed these partitions A and B. A has cardinality N1, and B has cardinality N2, D1. Alpha i's, where I is inside A, the set A, and a point class. Okay. Okay, so what is this? This is what that is. Yes. So then that is times, I need to plug in P2 class in here. So I 0 B plus 1 D2 of P2 alpha I. I invade B. Then plus the same thing. So 0 by 0 A plus 1 D1 of alpha I in A. Replace this with the line class times the same thing. With the line class in here. Alpha I. B, and the final thing, I think it's obvious what to put. Now the statement is that looks kind of many terms to compute, but many of them are actually zero. Okay, so many of these terms are zero. disturbs. Zero. So, for instance, let's write it this way. So, if we consider I zero A plus one E one alpha I find A and some gamma class, where gamma could be either point or the line class or the fundamental cycle of P2, then first of all, by our condition on this set A, we know that alpha R is going to be equal to alpha S equal to class of a line, and alpha I's are equal to class of a point, all of them, the rest of them. Otherwise, okay, and so hence, by the fact that some of the degrees of alpha I's should be equal to basically the degree axiom, hence degree axiom, by degree axiom, we see that this should be 3d plus 3d1 plus 2 minus 1 half degree of gamma. And since A is fixed, this partition is fixed, this determines D1 again. So only one of them at most is not matched. You have this uniquely determines the pair D1 gamma. So that's it. Only one of the terms is going to survive. The rest of them are going to be zero by the axioms. Argument, which is more or less right now, I think, obvious, and I will end it in here, maybe. Maybe I can say. Yeah, I mean, seems like it is getting involved, but eventually, this is the result we obtain. The sigma image of phi AB, where there is more to it, but I don't have time. So this becomes AD plus ND1, ND2. So then you have the other side of that divisor. So you have these divisors, you permute the points, you have these two linearly equivalent divisors. Each time you intersect them with this Gramov-Witten class psi, you calculate, basically. I didn't tell you what's the combinatorics, but it's kind of really this combinatorial argument, how to obtain this from that formula. Only one of the terms survives, and then you need to actually calculate it. You will get something like this. You need to argue on, basically, because the sum is over all partitions A and B, which do contain these fixed points in them, you need to actually argue on the size of A and B. Minimal size of A and B is obviously 2, right? So you argue on the size. You increase the size, and then you can calculate. I don't have time to talk about it. If you want, I can do it. But I claim this is just simple combinatorics. obtain the formula. This is one side of that formula. This is not the identity we wanted to prove. This is just one of them. This is one piece. Then we need to do it for the other divisor, and then we need to pack it up. But this is just an example of how this computation goes.
So just to simply check, what we're saying is that this is one way I derive like the intersection of my directional design with some A and B, TAB.
That's right.
And I get one formula. And then I have another one. I use equivalence condition. I get some other TA prime, B prime.
That's right.
And I get another formula. And then those two on the right side are
that's right.
related by the equivalence condition.
That's exactly.
That's how I get it.
That's right. Okay. That's right. Equivalence condition, axiom, forces them to be the same, up to a sum. Because yeah, each time that you will get this map to the moduli space, 0n, that's by fixing the partition. Every time you use the divisor axiom, you're fixing the partition. But that's fine because we have equivalence axioms. It's independent. But just an example. But the rest of it, just please do go and look at the notes of Fulton, Panderbale, or the book of the Sheldon Cats. You can see the combinatorics that goes there. Some, how many choices of, I don't know, these you can just see. It's best there. I don't have time for it. Any questions? So I think that's a stop in here for the grammar Witten invariance because, you know, I think it's a long and unnecessary story to talk about genus zero, Gram-Witten invariance of Quintic, for instance, or Calabi-Yau threefolds. But then I would suggest starting from next week, let us go and discuss quantum cohomology. I think we do know enough about what goes into Gram-Witten theory to discuss quantum cohomology. These axioms are the most important.